Every time you turn on low power mode, you disable features that Apple in its own keynotes called an essential part of the iPhone experience. ProMotion, background app refresh, 5G, the list is long. And no, this isn't another video about preserving your battery health. That's the obvious story and it's not that interesting. What interests me is how a technical problem that Apple should have solved 10 years ago has now become a direct threat to the entire development strategy of the iPhone lineup. This all lies in the realm of design, at the intersection of operating system design, one specific feature, and hardware design. And at the crossroads of these three, a collapse is happening right now. I've been in design for 22 years and I'm used to looking at products like a doctor. There's the disease and there are its symptoms. Apple's real disease is the fundamental unsolvable conflict between the pursuit of weightless, magical design and the brutal laws of physics. And we see the symptoms of this disease everywhere. But the most dangerous symptom is this button, because unlike the others, it affects not just the hardware, but the vital principles of Apple itself. Here are the official numbers from Apple. Over 10 years, the iPhone's battery life has doubled. An engineer looking at this graph is proud. But the consumer looking at their battery icon at 5 p.m. is anxious. Both are right. So why don't we feel this incredible progress? It turns out the problem isn't with lithium-ion technology, the problem is with us. In Through the Looking Glass, the Red Queen tells Alice, it takes all the running you can do to keep in the same place. This perfectly describes the arms race between battery capacity and our digital appetites. Yes, the battery has become twice as resilient, but the predators hunting it have become many times more voracious. The screens got brighter and faster. 5G is constantly searching for a network. The processors now perpetually busy with machine learning tasks never truly sleep. We got a more resilient horse, but we immediately loaded it with twice the cargo. By the end of the day, we're both equally exhausted. On top of that, our brain is lazy. It uses a cognitive anchor. For years, our experience has been anchored to a single fact. The phone dies by evening. The brain doesn't bother with complex calculations. It sees a familiar picture, 20% charge, and draws a simple conclusion, nothing has changed. But before we look on this timeline for understanding what exactly goes on here, a quick pause. I create these pictures in Recraft, today's video sponsor. But before we go to the placement itself, I use Recraft as a designer and even taught how to use it to design teams in some big companies. So it's not just an advertisement, it's the product I use, no matter if I have an ad contract or not. And for this video, I tested their new feature, the chat mode. I wrote that I needed a pencil sketch specifically so the icons would be in the same style, and I chose Nano Banana simply because it's a model I'm familiar with. But the service knows better which models are suitable for what. So it suggested that for my purposes, Recraft's own model might be a better fit than Nano Banana, and I agreed. Then it outlines what it's going to do. Moreover, it has a good knowledge of its pre-trained styles, and it selected the one that best matched my request. When it got the result, it looked at it and saw that what I asked for, a black background, wasn't there. And since it knows its model, it understands that the pencil sketch style implies white paper. So instead of just trying to regenerate, it acted smartly and switched to a model that follows the prompt better. The second result was exactly according to the brief, but noticeably more boring, and this is where the main strength of the new feature reveals itself. Instead of settling for a boring solution in chat, you can take the result and seamlessly switch to the canvas for precise manual adjustments. Then you can go back to the chat and ask for variations based on your changes. Imagine starting a logo in chat, switching to the canvas to perfect the curves, and then returning to chat for color variations. The context never breaks, all the tools work together. And from there, you can do even more impressive things, like place that new logo in an office interior or turn it into a tattoo sketch. If you want to try this before anyone else, join Recraft's chat mode waitlist. The link's in my description. Look at the timeline. Android introduced its battery saver mode in late 2014. Apple followed suit almost a year later with iOS 9. Why did they wait? They were observing. And they weren't solving a technical problem, but a reputational one. And here is their brilliant solution. Why does the mode always turn off at 80% charge? So you don't accidentally leave it on and start complaining about a slow iPhone. This isn't about caring for you. It's about protecting the brand from itself. They are so afraid of you seeing seeing their product as imperfect that they forcibly return you to the magic as soon as the crisis has passed. This ritual is familiar to everyone, the 20% remaining notification. And your finger, as if with a will of its own, performs the practiced action. Relief washes over you. But it's not the relief of solving a problem, it's the relief of surrender. The low power mode button is an ideological tool. It gives us the illusion of control. We press it and feel like we're in charge. But in reality, we aren't managing the situation, we are merely choosing how to accept it. In psychology, this is called learned helplessness. Instead of solving the fundamental problem, Apple gave us a button that teaches us not to fight back. It says, yes, your phone can't handle it, but you can help by giving up some of its features. And so, a normalization of deviance occurs. The yellow icon has transformed from an alarm signal into a routine part of the day. We no longer get outraged that a $1,500 phone can't run at full power from morning to night. Instead, we praise ourselves for turning on economy mode in time. The problem is reframed from an engineering flaw to a user's responsibility. And this is where the most important thing happens. The button starts to change us. We enter economy mode along with the phone. The phone, which was supposed to serve us, begins to train us. We own one of the most powerful computers in history, but we're afraid to use its power. This is the quiet victory of a corporation over consumer expectations. We've been taught to call a compromise a feature and to press its button with a sense of dignity. But what exactly are we losing? Here's what the benchmark data says. CPU performance drops by over 50%. Graphics by almost 40%. But what do these numbers mean for you personally? It means your favorite game turns from a smooth adventure into a slideshow. It means that perfect photo at the nightclub, which should have processed in a couple of seconds, makes you wait for six and the moment is lost. You're paying for a supercar, but most of the time you're only allowed to use the economy engines. Knowing all this, the main question arises. Why is the company voluntarily worsening this problem? The answer lies not in technology, but in business. Look at these phones. It's been almost 5 years since the iPhone 12 with no major visual changes. This broke the familiar pattern. I have the latest iPhone, and it shows. And that status is a critical sales driver. Novelty is needed like air, especially now when technological stagnation is obvious and the local loss in the AI race is plain to see. So what does Apple do? The same thing as the Marvel Cinematic Universe, which, fearing a loss of hype, brings back Robert Downey Jr. Apple is returning to its old proven trick, being ultra thin. There it is, the physical embodiment of this business strategy. But what does this mean for you? It means that if Apple shrinks the battery for the sake of thinness, you will be living in low power mode permanently. It will transform from an emergency measure into a daily routine. And now, knowing all this, we arrive at the main paradox. At the same time as shrinking the battery in the iPhone 17 Air, Apple is introducing the biggest design overhaul since iOS 7, which requires enormous computing power. Shrinking the battery while simultaneously increasing the load on it, isn't that shooting yourself in the foot? Ultimately, we've all fallen into a trap. In psychology, there's a concept called the hedonic treadmill. Its essence is simple. Humans quickly get used to good things. A doubled battery capacity isn't perceived as a luxury. It becomes the new normal. And now any drop below 100% once again triggers the same background anxiety. Progress has occurred, but our perception has reset to the starting point. And this is where we end up. A modern thin phone, especially an Air, is impossible without a power bank. It's like the dongle era for MacBooks, but for your phone. The new iPhone is a beautiful but incomplete product. Its other invisible half is the power bank in your pocket. I myself treated them as disposable for a long time, until I started choosing higher quality models. But why is Apple returning to glass and skeuomorphism after a long period of flat design? We'll cover that in detail in the video Apple Design, Why We Keep Coming Back to This. See you there. Bye.